Woo, good morning, everybody. How you doing? I'd like to welcome East Coast Christian Center. It really doesn't matter where you're sitting. If you're sitting in the Parkway, you're sitting in the Avenue, you're sitting in Cocoa, you're sitting in Vieira, man, you're all part of the family. And I just love that analogy and the word. There's a lot of ways that the body of Christ is described, and my favorite is family. And welcome, family. Good to have you here. Good to be preaching. Good to be back in the pulpit again. And I'm really grateful. So let's give everybody a warm welcome that's here today, eh? Yeah. We're going to pray in just a moment. I would like to kind of start out with a little bit of a story. When I first moved to Florida, this area of Florida, one of the reasons we did, we Carol and I had been feeling for about 3 years that we were supposed to leave Colorado and move to Florida. And as we just, you know, held that before the Lord, you know, how stuff like that builds, and it just built, and we got to the point where, yeah, okay, what, how do we do this? I used to live here and was raised here, and so it was kind of coming home for me. And Mike Black, who is our missionary in Guatemala, actually lived in this area and had started a church, and he was pastoring a small church in the area, and he called me and said, Dan, would you consider coming to this part of Florida and consider pastoring the church that I started in Rockledge? And I said, well, let us pray about it. After we prayed about it, my answer was, we'll come. We felt like we were supposed to come. And we'll go to the church for 6 months, and then we'll make a decision after that. You and me and Carolyn and Pat and God, we'll get together and we'll figure out what we're supposed to do. And after 6 months, we really felt like we weren't supposed to do that. That was before we started coming here. We did shortly thereafter, started coming to this church. Back when it was called Word Alive, and it was an incredible adventure. But Mike ended up leaving the pastorate because he wanted to become a missionary. And he felt in his heart he'd never been there, but he wanted to go to Guatemala. Well, it just so happened I had a really close friend that I worked with in Colorado who had moved to Guatemala about 5 years previous and was a missionary there. And so I could introduce my friend Doug Wurzbauer in Guatemala, who knew the ropes and had gone to language school in Quito. And he had actually been the guy who led me in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, many of you know that Mike Black, our missionary in Guatemala, actually led Carolyn and I to the Lord. And so now I get led to the Lord by Mike, and I get led in the baptism of the Holy Spirit by Doug. So these guys are really close to me. And then I got to lead Mike in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, after what I'd learned, you know, in my process with God and with Doug. And so really, there's a close connection, but there's no connection between Mike and Doug except me. And so I said, let's just go to Guatemala. I'll introduce you. If it's a fit and, you know, God says yes, great, and we did. So we're in Guatemala, and we're, you know, it's a look-and-see kind of trip, and we're spying out the land. And so Mike's, you know, getting a feel for God, what God's saying in his heart. We're going around. What you got to understand about these two guys are if there was night and day, that would be Mike and Doug. Mike's a very serious guy. I love him. One of my best friends in the world, and get along great. If I don't see him for 5 years and see him, we're just like we always were. Great guy, but a very serious guy. Doug, on the other hand, I don't think he's ever been serious in his life. Doug is 6'5" and 300 pounds and played college quarterback and pitcher in the baseball team and, you know, power forward on the basketball team. He's a big boy, and he was like 240 when he was quarterback and, you know, 300 now. Anyway, moving right along. I don't know where he's at right now. I haven't seen him in a while. He might be pushing 350. Who knows? He's a big man. And Mike, we're there. So we're in Guatemala. We're actually going up to Antigua, where the language schools are. And so I'm going to look at the area and find out about going to language school there so Mike and Pat can begin to learn the language. And we're on the road to Antigua. And as we're going on the road, something strange begins to happen. We're riding in Doug's Volkswagen van. And it has a Porsche engine in it, so it's real snappy. It's real fast. But it's got a big windshield, and Mike is in the shotgun, and Doug is driving. And I'm in a bench seat right in between them, so I have a good view of the windshield too. We're on a road, it's two lanes, one up the mountain, one down the mountain, I never saw a line on the road. You know, here we have lines on the road, and they kind of tell you a little bit about what you're supposed to do. Well, in Guatemala, no lines, And if there were signs, I didn't notice any. And if they were in Spanish, I wouldn't have been able to read them anyway. So here we are on this road going up to Antigua, and we're buzzing along. And Doug, the strange things begin to happen. Doug's kind of like, he's like, yes, Lord, and he's praying in the Spirit, and yes, Lord, and if you don't know what praying in the Spirit is, you can come up and talk to the prayer counselors after the service, and they'll get you fixed up, and you can pray in the Spirit too. But anyway, moving right along, Doug's praying in the Spirit, he's going, yes, Lord, he says, now, Lord, and under his breath, he's having this little conversation, and Mike begins to notice it, and I begin to notice it, and he goes, oh, and he passes this car. Okay, that's interesting. And it begins to happen more as we're going up the mountain. And it begins to happen not just passing when it looks safe, but passing on the uphill with the crest of the hill in front of you. And I want to tell you, when the semis roll down the mountain from Antigua, if one of them hit you, they wouldn't even slow down. They wouldn't even go back to look to see if there were any pieces left, all right? And Doug would go, yes, Lord, now? And he'd go, right up the hill. I mean, you could not see what was over the hill. He's like, and there would be nobody there. And I mean, now the wild part was, I knew Doug really well, and I knew he wouldn't kill me. And so it was a little bit difficult to figure out what was going on, and I didn't figure out what was going on. But I had a little bit more comfort than poor Mike did. Because like I said, Mike's serious, Doug's kind of a funny guy. And so it goes on, and then finally, one more time, Doug does it, and Mike loses it. And Mike just swings around at Doug. Now, these guys have just met through me, about 3 or 4 days before. And Mike says, this has got to stop. You got to stop this right now. This is crazy. And Doug wheels around, sticks his finger in his face, says, look, buddy, if you're going to ever be a missionary, you're going to have to learn to walk by faith and not by sight. And goes, hits the gas and passes somebody else. On a curve. Well, at that point, Mike goes beyond losing it, and he's starting to open the door and saying, you got to stop. You let me out of here. I'm not driving in this van with you. And Doug starts just roaring with laughter. And what we found out later, Doug explained to us, is this two-lane road, one up, one down, had passing lanes, but you couldn't tell when they were occurring because the road would split, and the one lane coming down the mountain was on the other side of the jungle, like the trees, and it still looked like your same two-lane road, but Doug knew it was a passing lane, and we were never in any danger at all. Yeah. and I've actually been with Doug when he's done that to other people, and it's a lot of fun. But it's more fun when you know there's a passing lane there than when you don't know there's a passing lane there. So it was a lot more fun the second time I did it than the first time I did it with Doug. And that's the way it works. If Mike would have known what Doug knew and could have seen the way Doug saw, Mike would have been totally relaxed because he would have perceived something differently than he was perceiving it. Now, a really funny part is Pastor Brian was in Guatemala many years after this, like 25 years later, and they were driving up a winding road, and Pastor Brian asked Mike about it. And Mike is still mad today. He's still fired up. He was like, that was not funny. That was his first response to Pastor Brian. That was not funny. One of the funniest things I've ever experienced in my life. And Doug just kind of liked that. I want to talk today about being unstoppable. And the way to do that, I believe the only way to do that is, of course, to follow Jesus. Because God is the unstoppable one. Turn to your neighbor and say, God's unstoppable. See, it isn't the devil doing stuff and God responding. God, the devil is trying to catch up. And God is unstoppable. And if we'll follow God and we'll have faith in God and we'll learn to walk by faith and not by sight, we can become unstoppable too. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your love and care for us. We thank you for your word, which is true. Lord, it's a real world we're living in. It's solid. It's we can feel it, see it, touch it, taste it, hear it, smell it, God. It's here, and it's screaming at us a lot of times. And there's a spirit realm that is unseen but powerful. Today we want to learn a little bit more about focusing in on you, the unseen God, and believing and perceiving the circumstances and situations of life through the lens of your word and the power of your spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen. In the Word of God, in Hebrews 11, 1, it's really, if you've ever looked for a definition of faith, that's where it's found, Hebrews 11, 1. And in the New King James Version, we'll throw it up here on the screen for you, it says, now faith, I like that, now faith. Later faith doesn't work that well, and yesterday's faith is not that valuable, but now faith. See, you got to believe now. The Bible says, when you pray, believe that you receive, and you shall have it. When do you have to believe? When you pray. When are you going to get it? Well, you shall have it. But it's now. You got to get in the place where you're going to believe right now, this is what God wants for me. This is what God promises. I'm going to believe it, and I'm going to receive it now, faith, and then I shall have it. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the substance of things hoped for. Now listen to this, the evidence of things not seen. Faith is for the unseen realm. Faith takes what's in the unseen realm, the spiritual realm, in the Word of God and brings it out of the Word of God and into your life. Faith is what grabs hold of it, doesn't let go of it, and brings it into the world. Now, your part is to have faith. Now, it's God. God, it's still not faith in you. It's faith in God. God's the one who's doing it. God's the one who promised it. God's the one who said it. But your job is to have faith. Amen. And not quit, not give up. You shall reap in due season if you faint not, the Bible says. Got to keep believing. Somebody say, keep believing. Turn to your neighbor and say, keep believing. Here, there used to be a book out there, still is. I mean, back in the day, we used books to actually study, which is amazing. Now we use electronic devices. You know, I just use my computer. I never get off of it. I never have to turn a page. It's right there. You do a search, boom, it's right there in your face. But there used to be a book called 26 Translations, and it basically took from 26 translations and would maybe give you 6, 7, 8 of them for every verse in the New Testament. And so this verse from the 26th translation, I want to read you a couple. From the NIV, the last part of it, which says the evidence of things not seen. From the NIV, it says, certain of what we do not see. What is faith? Faith is what makes us certain. Now faith is what makes us certain of what we do not see. Is there anybody here that's believing God for something they haven't seen yet? You're in faith. That's what faith is. Faith is believing even before you see it. New American Standard says the conviction of things not seen. The Waymouth translation says a conviction of the reality of the things we do not see. A conviction of the reality. Do you have a reality of the unseen realm? Is it real to you? Faith makes it real to you. I'll say more about that in a minute. In the New English Bible, it says, makes us certain of realities we do not see. What does faith does? Faith makes you certain of the realities you do not see. In the Williams translation, it says, faith is the proof of the reality of the things we cannot see. The Montfort translation says, the putting to the proof of the things we do not see. Now, the Amplified translation, I'll read the whole verse, says, now faith is the assurance, the confirmation, the title deed of the things we hope for being the proof of things we do not see and the conviction of their reality, faith perceiving as real fact what is not revealed to the senses. Faith perceiving as real fact what's not perceived by the senses. I can't see it yet. I can't hear it yet. I can't feel it yet. I can't smell it yet. I can't taste it yet. But I have a promise from God, and I believe the promise, which means I have it now. That's faith. What's like your salvation? How many people in here have seen Jesus with your natural eyes? I'm putting my hands in my pocket. Yet you're all in church, and you all sang songs to him a little while ago. Isn't that amazing? You know what that is? That's faith. You demonstrated your faith when you came in here to worship Jesus, whom none of us have ever seen before. None of us were at Calvary when he died and bled for us. None of us met Mary, his virgin mother. None of us have seen the Holy Spirit. Yet we believe. That's faith. Faith is our proof, our evidence. Now, that doesn't mean we haven't perceived God or felt God or experienced God or the Holy Spirit or Calvary's effects. We all have done that, and obviously that's why we're here, because our faith has brought into reality many of the benefits and promises of our relationship with Jesus. And because our faith, our belief in Jesus, when we said, I believe that he died for me, I believe that he rose from the dead, when we said that, we experienced in our lives the reality of deliverance from sin, of freedom from guilt and oppression, deliverance of bondage and addictions. How? We simply said, I believe. In what? An unseen God. Faith lives in, deals with the unseen realm. Once you see it, when you get to heaven, you won't need any faith that Jesus is Lord anymore. He'll prove it to you. He'll be right there. Come on. It's not, I'll believe it when I see it. It's, I'll see it when I believe it. Only people that will ever see Jesus without being forced to their knees will people who believe it before they see it. Faith operates in the unseen. 2 Corinthians 5:7 says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. How do you live the Christian life? You live it by faith. You have to live it by faith. You can't live it by sight, because your sight's going to give you all sorts of crazy things to deal with that are contrary to the kingdom of God, the family of God, and the life of Christ. So we're going to have to live by faith. We're going to have to walk by faith and not by sight. See, there's two realms that we live in. We live in a physical realm, and what Doug was doing was Doug was playing a game, and what he was acting like he was doing was using his spiritual eyes or his spiritual way of seeing, his faith, to walk in the natural realm. He was pretending he was passing cars on a curve or an uphill by faith, by listening to God and doing it. God has not ordained for us to do that kind of stuff, by the way. He's giving us, he wants you to use your physical eyes to walk around and not fall down and trip. I don't do this by faith. I use my natural senses to get around up here. God gave me those, and they're very good for getting around in the natural. But if I'm going to maneuver or move around in the spiritual, I'm going to have to use the eye of faith. The only way you're going to be successful in your Christian life is to look through some of the natural things that are being thrown at you and see what God has promised you. Reality. See, here's the truth. The unseen realm is more real than the seen realm. This is the seen realm. We can touch it, feel it, but here's the truth. This was all made by an unseen God. Which is more real, what was made or who made it? You made it. In fact, this is what it says in 2 Corinthians 4:16. Therefore, we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing. It's talking about how naturally we're perishing. Yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, or what we're going through in this world, which is but for a moment, is working for us a more exceeding and eternal way to glory. What's going on in this life can work for you something wonderful and full of glory if you do one thing. What is that? It says next, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. See, how can I say this? It says, working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Weight of glory, what is that? Just real quick. This little piece of paper here, if it was on this pulpit and we had a fan set up here and it was blowing hard, it would blow this piece of paper off of here because this piece of paper doesn't have enough weight to stay on here. But all I'd need to do to keep the paper there is put my Bible on it. What did I do? I added weight to the paper. And the paper's not blown away by the wind. How do you have enough weight in your life not to get blown around by life's circumstances? You focus on the right thing. You look at the right thing. You see the right thing. You walk by faith and not by sight. Could be any area of your life. Every one of us is dealing with something. Every one of us is believing God for something. Every one of us has maybe had you know, something come up in our life in the last whatever year, 2 years, 10 years, whatever it is, day, this morning, I don't know what it was, but where you've had an opportunity to let that move you, or you've had an opportunity to look through it. It's still there. It's real. We're not denying it's reality. We're just denying its reality to rule our life. We look through it. What happens? The weight of the glory of God comes into your life when you believe God and you're not blown away by the bad report or the circumstance or situation that's coming at you. Practically speaking, we've got to use the right set of eyes for the right circumstance. Remember when Peter was out in the boat and he and the disciples were told to get in the boat by Jesus and go to the other side? So they got instruction from Jesus, but Jesus didn't get in the boat with them. Now, they didn't want to get in the boat because Peter was a fisherman and he could see the approaching storm. When a fisherman doesn't want to get in the boat and go fishing, that's probably a pretty good bet that there's going to be problems. And so Peter says, you know, like, this doesn't look good. And Jesus said, get in the boat, go to the other side. And they get in the boat and go to the other side. And as they are, the storm hits and they're rowing most of the night trying to get the other side. And the boat's filling up with water. And they're, you know, I guess he's got Thomas, you know, you get the bail because you're the doubter. Come on, get over there. I don't know, you know, Peter and or James and John, you guys are too mean to people. You guys bail or whatever. And so they're rowing for all they can get the other side. And Jesus comes walking on the water. The Bible says he would have passed them by. That blows my mind. One of the reasons it blows my mind, now listen to me here, is one, you think, well, doesn't he care? Why wouldn't he stop? But it's more than that. See, when Jesus gives you his word on something, go to the other side, go, there's enough power in that word to get you there. So Jesus didn't feel a need to stop and give him another word because he'd already given the word to get to the other side. So he just said, I told you to go, I'm going to go, so I'll see you over there, guys. Bye. It's just like, almost like, that's the kind of faith Jesus walks on. Well, that was Jesus. Yeah, but he wants us to imitate him. He wants us, you know, he was the first Adam. Excuse me, he was the last Adam. We're sons of Jesus now. And he wants us to be like him. See, Jesus did what he did as the Son of Man, not the Son of God. He did. I don't have time to get into that, but was he Son of God? Fully Son of God. But he laid down his deity and he picked up our humanity. And he got filled with the Holy Spirit. And he had to believe God too. And I can just prove to you real quick, he had to believe God, and it was a job sometimes, because when he was hanging on Calvary, he said, God, why have you forsaken me? That's a real man crying out and having questioning faith. There's nothing wrong with having questioning faith. You can ask God those questions. He's not afraid of them. But Peter's in the boat. Jesus goes walking on the water, and they thought it was a ghost. They got scared. Anyway, Jesus basically said, it's me. And Peter said, if it's you, bid me or ask me to come on the water. Now, that is a bad way to ask Jesus anyway, anything, because Jesus had no options. Like, if it's you, tell me to come on the water. Well, okay, Peter, that's a bad idea for you to come on the water. It's not me. He couldn't do that. So he said, come. And Peter got out of the boat and walked on water. That's way beyond me. That's like another level. But Peter walked on the water. And when he was walking on the water towards Jesus, things were good. But when he opened his eyes to the wind, how hard it was blowing, and the waves, how big they were, he began to sink. Reality? Absolutely. Storm? Absolutely. Jesus? Absolutely. Peter walking on water? Absolutely. But his focus changed everything for him. When he began to sink, he cried, Jesus. Jesus put out his hand. They both walked together back to the boat. Pretty amazing story. But a real encouragement for us on where to point our eyes. You in a storm in life right now? You better be looking at Jesus, and you better be looking at his promise. You know what? You can Google it. Actually, there's a website called iwillgooglethatforyou.com. I'm serious. And people use it when they want to punch you in the nose. Like if you're on a forum or a discussion or a blog and you say, hey, do you know anywhere I could buy, you know, an air conditioner? They'll go, I could Google that for you. Because right now we're in the information age and you can Google anything and find it. It's amazing. I can fix anything right now. It's incredible. I go to YouTube and I can learn more about installing an air conditioner. I went to school in high school for 2 years for air conditioning and I couldn't install an air conditioner. My life depended on it from that 2 years training. But I can go on YouTube 5 minutes later, I can install an air conditioner. And you don't believe me? I did just the other day, installed an air conditioner, mini split in our house. YouTube is amazing. Oh, I can Google that for you. Just Google it, man. You'll see. Install mini split. Boom, it's in. Glory. Aren't I good? Well, I got news for you. If you're going to try to get through this life, the storms of this life, Googling it and focusing in on all the garbage. You know, I don't know about you guys. You just see the ads for medicine. They go, you know, and they just start telling you what can go wrong if you take this medicine. You know what I mean? Like, you know. Blindness, you know. You will die eventually, but it'll be after all your kids die and your dog dies and your house burns down. And, you know, I mean, there's a super long list of horrible things, you know, that can happen to you, but this is the best thing since sliced bread. And so you read the stuff about this illness that you're dealing with, and you read it, and you get all this information, and then you go, now I'm going to walk by faith. And your head is just going boom, boom, boom with all this information. And it's like the wind and the waves. And they just crush you. Man, if you're dealing with something, Google how to eat right about it. Google, you know, some positive things you can do, but don't become an expert. Be simple concerning evil and wise concerning good. Don't fill your head with that garbage, because that's what you'll focus on. And what you focus on and what you see, you draw towards you. Don't have time to explain that. It just happens. Let me read you. Let me or fill in. Never judge an answer to prayer by what you see. If you're here believing for something today, that doesn't mean your prayer wasn't answered when you prayed it. It just means you're still in faith. The time to when you don't need to believe anymore is after you see it. If you haven't seen it yet, you still need to be believing God. Proverbs 4:20 says, "My son, give attention to my word, incline your ear to my sayings." That's great advice. It doesn't say, "Look, I could Google that for you." Proverbs 4:20, "I will Google that for you." That doesn't say that. Now, I know we live in a different age, but the principles of living in this age are the same as they've always been. What you focus on, you go towards. "My son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings." Listen to this. "Do not let them depart from your eyes." What do you see? "I see by his stripes I'm healed." I have to deal with that a lot. I have to think about that and put that, keep that in front of my eyes a lot. I have reminders in the natural that try to remind me that I'm not healed or I'm not well in an area or two of my life. Talked about last week about, you know, sometimes part of our bodies talks to us. If you go on from here, "Keep them in the midst of your heart." It says, "For their life to those that find them, health to all their flesh. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it springs the issues of life." And then it ends up saying, "Let your eyes look straight ahead and your eyelids look right before you." You got to keep your eyes focused on where you're going. You got to see what you need to see. Beginning of it says, "Incline your ear to my sayings." What are you listening to? What are you watching? What are you looking at? They affect how you believe and how victorious or successful you are in your believing. When I was a young Christian, I was learning about this. I had a wart on my arm. I have this little thing that in Colorado, where we lived, where it was cooler than this a lot, most like always, but anyway, moving right along. When you would move your arm, my jacket comes up. See how my jacket comes up? Well, the wart was like right there, and it was like as big as my head. Aren't warts always as big as your head? They really aren't, but they seem it because they're on you, and warts are nasty things. And anyway, so I had this wart, and every time I'd move, my shirt or my jacket would come up, and it would catch, and when it would go back down, I'd catch on that wart and go click, and it'd be like, gross. You'd look down at it and say, "Oh, it grew today. It's twice the size it was yesterday." It wasn't, but, you know, it's just there. And I felt like, you know, "Oh, but I'm healed. Can I deal with that?" And so I felt like I was just going to curse it. "I curse you in Jesus' name. Get off my body." But then click, click on my jacket, click, click. So finally, I just had to turn that into something. I had to quit looking at it. And so I refused to look at it. You may think this is crazy, but I don't think it's crazy. I think that's what the Bible says. We walk by faith and not by sight. So I'm not going to look at it anymore. And every time I click it, I'm going to say, "By his stripes, we were healed." Click, "By his stripes, we were healed." Click. It got to be such a reaction that I began to forget about the wart and just began to think about what God's word said. And it was a process. I don't know how long. It was at least 6 months of, you know, having this thing go on in me. And I was at a person's house. We were having a Bible study. And I had my hands up, and we were just worshiping God, and somebody was playing the guitar or something. We were worshiping God, singing a song, and, you know, Kumbaya or something, or, you know, I don't know what it was. And I felt like in my heart, I heard this little, still small voice say, "Look at your arm." And I said, "Get behind me, Satan." "By stripes, we were healed." And I felt this little nudge again. "No, no, it's okay. Look at your arm." "Oh, no way. I trained myself not to look at that stupid arm. I'm looking at that arm. I'm healed." "One more time. Look at your arm." I did. It was gone. We walk by faith and not by sight. Got to learn to walk by faith and not by sight. And it's not always easy. when your checkbook is really, really screaming at you. It's time to buy school supplies for your kids. I get it. When you want them to be, you know, when they've got a little style and you want them to be dressed nice. That's not easy. But it's the way we're called to live. We walk by faith and not by sight. And if you will walk by faith and not by sight, you'll get to the place where you have enough to buy your kids school clothes and then buy some other kids some school clothes too. Because that's what it's all about, right? It isn't all about just getting me what I need. It's all about walking in the promises of God and then seeing other people walk in the promises of God. I'll close with this, there's a story in the Bible about Abraham and Lot. And they were so blessed and so prosperous where they were living that they got too big to live together. Their herds were bumping into each other when they needed to use the well or any of the stuff. There just wasn't room anymore. And so Abraham, who was the kind of the God guy, and Lot, who was a little bit more the natural guy, got together, and Abraham says, here's what we're going to do. You pick something, and if you go this way, I'll go that way. And if you go this way, I'll go that way. It doesn't matter what you pick. Why didn't it matter to Abraham what he picked? Because he's walking by faith, not by sight. And he knew that whatever way he went, whatever direction he went, God would be there. And what was going on in the natural wouldn't determine how Abraham ended up. He knew that because he was the original faith guy. And we are called to walk in the steps of faithful Abraham. That's what the Bible says. And so they get to this point, and it says in verse 10 of Genesis 13, and Lot lifted his eyes and saw all the plain of the Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere. Anybody know what area this was? Sodom and Gomorrah. But it was before it was destroyed, and it was beautiful. It was like the Garden of Eden, the Bible says. And when he lifted up his eyes, he saw, man, I can go have the best land. Look at everything that's there. And he walked by sight and not by faith. And he ended up in a place that destroyed him and his family and destroyed his life. Why? Because he chose to walk by what his eyes told him instead of what his heart, walking with God, told him, or what the Word of God told him. Abraham, we know, ended up with everything. Why? Because he walked by faith and not by sight. Bow your heads just for a moment. If this is new to you, all I can say is that the more you do it, the easier it will get. The more you do it, the easier it will get. But even if you used to do this, you can lose this. You can walk by faith for a long period in your life, and you can lose this and start just walking by sight. So wherever you're at today, whether you're just getting started, whether you used to do it and you stopped, or whether you still are, I just want to ask you one question. What is it that God wants you to begin to see by faith again today? Is it that marriage being everything you want it to be? Instead of focusing in on the little bumps in the road or the big bumps in the road? Is it that child coming home? Is it that job that you need to see turned around, that business you see need? Is it a physical thing in your body that needs to become well? What is it that you need to believe God again and see it by faith? Pick that up again. Find some promises in the Word that agree with what you feel like God's telling you to pick up. And begin to again walk by faith, or start to walk by faith and not by sight. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We honor you. Thanks for the help that you give us. Show us things in your Word that will help us in this process. Remind us by your Spirit to choose what you said over the circumstances and the natural things our senses are screaming at us. And Lord, may that thing that's contrary today to your Word be a testimony to your glory tomorrow. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody say, amen and amen.